pizza. Don't find the pizza. Water there. And where we've seen a couple of hippos, we're likely to see
A few more up ahead, since they aren't very social animals. They're usually found in a large group called a bloat. So as we continue to make our way past and around the river here, it does look like there are quite a few more hippos right over on the left-hand side of us as well.
Are also sometimes called African white.
on the right are a little bit shorter, so they're most likely slightly younger than the one we see here on the left. But giraffes are born already standing, about 6 feet tall, so they're definitely never short at any age of their life. Now, it's also not quite as common to see them lie down like that to rest. Most of the time when they sleep, they'll sleep standing up so that they can be ready to be on the move quickly if any predators do approach. In fact, sometimes they'll even sleep with their eyes still open, so it can be hard to tell if a giraffe you're looking at is asleep or awake. However, they don't need to sleep very often either. In order to prioritize as much time as possible for eating, the most important part of anyone's day, they actually only need to sleep up to about 30 minutes per day. And they get most of that 30 minutes of sleep in very short little power naps. We're going to make our way across some more open grasslands a little bit further up ahead. But if you look over in the shade of these trees here on the hill on the left, you can see a few more giraffes as well. And we had a very lucky safari with giraffes so far. Now further across those grasslands up ahead of us, you may also be able to see the stripes of some Hartman's Mountain zebras out there. Now, if we were to look a little bit more closely at each one of those zebras, we'd find that each and every one of their stripe patterns is just as unique as each of our fingerprints. And that's really helpful for any babies within the herd. Any foals should be able to follow closely behind their mother. They'll memorize her stripe patterns so they don't get lost within that large herd. You can also see quite a few wildebeest if you're lying down near those zebras. And closer to us, up on this hill here, one of my favorite residents of the Harambe Wildlife Reserve. These itty-bitty antelopes here on our right are springboks. They are the smallest species of antelope found living here on the Harambe Wildlife Reserve. They only stand up to about 3 feet tall at the shoulder. And they are small but mighty little antelopes. And those little legs of theirs can actually help them spring up into the air up to about 13 feet high. They can even run up to 55 miles per hour at their top speed. They're definitely a lot stronger than they look. Now in the shade of those palm trees a little bit further away from us on the right, you might also be able to see some massive horns poking out of the bushes there. Those are Ankole cattle. Those horns thankfully are not nearly as heavy as they look like they would be. Despite their large size, inside of those horns there's actually a honeycomb-like structure, which makes them look lighter. It also allows the cattle to side, it looks like we are going to get a pretty nice close-up view of that African elephant. And there's a few ways that we can tell this is an African elephant. For one, they are much larger than their Asian cousins. They also have much larger ears, which are often said to be roughly the shape of the continent of Africa. So the easiest way that we know that that is an African elephant, that we are in Africa right now, that's the only kind of elephant that we should be seeing out here. Thank you. make their way across farmland fields and eat some of the farmers' crops. That's also a big problem for those farmers, since those crops are, of course, their livelihood. But researchers here on the Wildlife Reserve actually were able to come up with a pretty unique solution to helping those humans and elephants share their space. They were able to create special beehive fences to surround the farmers' land. And even just the sound of bees buzzing can be enough to send a whole herd of elephants turning around, facing the opposite direction. If anyone ever tells you that elephants are afraid of mice, that's not true. They're afraid of something much smaller, just those itty-bitty bees out there. These fences have done a great job to help protect both the elephants and humans from any of those dangerous conflicts. And it gives the farmers some extra income from being able to sell the honey from Mickey. Those beehive fences as well.
Right here.
Definitely a win-win conservation success story for all involved.
In
this next watering hole over here on the left, we're also passing by a whole flock of flamboyants of greater flamingos. Greater flamingos get that name because they are the largest flamingo species, so not necessarily because they're better than any of the smaller flamingos out there. Lesser flamingos happen to be my personal favorite. And the smallest flamingos that you can see on this island over here on the left are those little gray fluff balls with legs. Those are fairly young flamingo chicks there. Flamingo chicks hatch out completely gray, just like you see here. But as they continue to grow up and eat more and more shrimp, rich in that beta-carotene pigment, they'll get more and more of that beautiful pink coloration, just like their parents. Now, it looks like there is a nice big mud wallow over here in the center of this clearing on the left. The only other big cat species that will live and hunt socially this way is the lion. blend in really well with the rocks and logs underneath the shade of those trees.
He's right there next to that tree.
There may be a few more warthogs resting in some of those burrows down there as well. They are the largest burrowing mammals. So they usually prefer to work smarter, not harder, so they don't dig their own burrows normally. Then they'll find burrows left behind by smaller mammals and do some remodeling with their own tusks to make them suit their own size and needs. Lying down in the center of those tall grasses there on the right-hand side, you can also see a couple of very special antelopes called bontebocs. One of the most special things about those bontebok antelopes is that at one time, there were only 17 of them left alive in the whole world. They were very endangered due to being hunted for those beautiful furs of theirs. But thankfully, the farmers who owned the land where those remaining bontebocs lived decided they wanted to play their part to help save that species. And they built a nice fence around all of that land to help keep poachers out. And since bontebocs are not nearly as good at jumping as most of the other antelopes we've seen today, they're not very good at jumping, those fences kept them nice and safe inside those protected lands, where their numbers were able to continue to grow. Their populations have since spread to more and more protected lands throughout Africa, including the Harambe Wildlife Reserve, reaching sustainable populations. That's one of my favorite stories, mostly because it's a really great example of how a small group of people can get together, working together and making a big difference for